Now we have the pleasure to start with Frédéric Blanqui, who is going to do an invited talk about the use of confluence in type theory in modular overwriting. Frédéric?
Well, okay, thank you very much
you can start.
For the introduction. And so thank you, Samuel and Mauricio, for your invitation. So to be frank, at the beginning, I was a little bit surprised by your invitation because it's quite some time I didn't work on Confluence. But so I am a user of Confluence results and Confluence tools. And so in this talk, I'm not going to show you new results on Confluence, but some problems where Confluence is useful. So namely in type theory modulo rewriting. So first I'm going to speak about the use of rewriting in proof assistance. And then I will give you some details on the problems that this raises. So in recent years, there is an increasing interest in using rewriting in proof assistance. So in particular in deducti, of course, so deducti is the system we develop in my team. And I will give much more details about this system later. But also in AGDA, for instance, for a few years, sorry about the slide. Okay. So for a few years now, AGDA developers, and especially Jesper Cox, added the possibility of adding rewrite rules in AGDA. And also in the COC community, there is recently some interest on this topic too, and but no implementation yet. But so there has been a few talks on the types workshop about this. So the common point, so perhaps I should share my screen. Oh, sorry. The common point between all these systems is that they use the dependent types. So I will also give more details about this. So if you look at the web page of AGDA and the documentation, so you will find this, for instance, so they explain how to add rewrite rules. And what is interesting also is that they implemented a confluence checker. So actually it's just for local confluence, but I think they are interested in adding some more advanced checking in for confluence, for full confluence. And so now I will give you some more details about deducti. So deducti is like AIDA, a purely functional programming language based on lambda calculus. So I put programming between double quotes because of course it's not like C or Java. There is no input output and so on, but you can find, you can define a lot of functions in such a system. So it's also using dependent types. So what does that mean? It means that types can take values as arguments. And we are going to see some examples just after. And so what is specific to deducti is that functions like addition and so on, but also types themselves can be defined and by rewrite rules in deducti. So deducti is an implementation of what we call so the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting. And so here is an example, a very simple example of definition of a type using rewriting. So you can see on the first line here that we define so the type n of natural numbers with a constructor zero on successor. And then we can define a function n which maps a natural number to a type. So here this is this type capital letter is to denote types in DDT. And if the argument is equal to zero, then we return the type of natural numbers n. But if it's a successor, then we define it as the euro type, and so the function type from natural numbers to recursive call with the predecessor. So for instance, here you have f of 2, which is equivalent to, which reduces to this type, functional type here. So what are the applications of DDT currently? So historically, it's used as a logic of homework. So it means that it is used for representing the theories and the proofs of many different logical systems. So Hall-Light, Koch, AGDA, PVS, and so on. And so if you want to get more details about this application of DDT, you can see the talk of Guillaume Genestier on July 3rd afternoon. It will present a translation from AGDA to DDT. So then it can also be used as an independent proof checker for all these systems, and also as a tool to transform proofs. So to translate, for instance, a proof from Hall-Light to Matita or the other way. So you can have a look at the web page of DDT. You can see here. So this page is the DDT version 2. But for a few years now, we are developing a new version. So that is called for the moment Lambda Pi. And the difference with the previous version is that it allows the building of proofs. And so in the previous version of DDT, it was possible to check only complete proofs. And in the new version, it's possible to consider partial proofs and to complete them using tactics. So what are the kind of rewrite rules we can have in DDT? Here is an example of rules. So what is specific to DDT in comparison to other systems like where you can define functions like, I don't know, languages like OCaml or Koch, for instance, is that you can have overlapping left-hand sides. So here you have the example of the addition of natural numbers, where so the first two rules define addition on the first argument, but you can also have at the same time the rules for when you define addition on the by induction on the second argument. Also, you can have matching on defined symbols. So, for instance, the addition that is defined with the previous rules, you can also add the rule for associativity, for instance. So, this is something that is not possible to do in the Koch system, for instance. And you can have non-linear rules, like for instance in group theory. So here, for instance, the addition of x plus the opposite of x is equal to zero. And finally, we can have higher order pattern matching. So the first example here is so the derivative of a sinus function composed with some other function f. And so you can see here that this pattern variable f is applied to a list of bound variables. So this is the usual condition of Miller for having a decidable pattern matching. But we can restrict the possible variables. So in the next line here, we can encode eta reduction. by saying that so this pattern variable f is must not depend on this bound variable x. And so to summarize, so we have all these features in DDT, and so Gabriel Ondet will give a talk on this topic also on July 3rd and explain the implementation of the new rewriting engine of DDT, which is based on the use of decision trees. And also, we have so confluence checking, well, the possibility of checking confluence in DDT. So we didn't implement anything in DDT, but we rely on translating DDT rules to the HRS format of the confluence competition. But there is a few problems with this translation, as you know. So the HRS format does not accept dependent types. So the translation will work only if we have only simple types. And so perhaps we could also use the TRS format, which is a standard untyped first order rewriting. But in this case, we cannot translate if we have abstractions in rules. So it would be nice to have either an extension of the HRS format to dependent types or an extension of the TRS format with lambda abstractions if we want to really check confluence of DDT rules. Okay, so this is the end of the presentation of DDT. So now I'm going to present in more details so the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting, so the system in which I am interested. And then I will discuss some properties and how confluence is used. So as I said just before, so the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting is based on the lambda calculus. So you have all the usual term constructors for lambda calculus. So you have constants so for function symbols or type symbols. You have variables, bound variables, the lambda abstraction, and the application of the lambda calculus. But then, so you have something special for dependent types, for representing types. So you have sorts. So there is the sort type for representing types that you have already seen in some examples. And another sort called kind, which is used for technical reasons. I'm not going to give more details about this in this talk. And then you have the dependent product, which is represented by this term here with a pi. And this is an extension of the function type of simply type lambda calculus, so R euro b. But the novelty is that in a dependent type, so the output type b can depend on x. Okay, so that's why you have this this constructor. And in case there is no occurrence of x in B, then we just write as usual the row type. So what you can remark here is in contrast to simply type lambda calculus is that terms and types are defined mutually. Okay, and then so for typing these terms, we use a typing environment, so just a sequence of declarations of a type for variables. And also we have rewrite rules. So here rewrite rules is just a function symbol applied to some arguments and reduces to some other term. Mm-hmm. So now, what are the typing rules? So the rules that will say what are the terms that are valid in this system. So first, you have rules for making sure that the typing environments are valid. Here. Then you have for each constructor, term constructor, you have a typing rule. So for instance, for function symbols, for variables, and for abstraction and application. So, but what you can see that is specific to dependent types is that in case of an abstraction, you get a dependent type because perhaps X may appear in the type B. And in case of an application, so you have a term T of some dependent type here applied to some argument U, and you see that the result of applying T to U as for type B, where we replace X by U. And so now you have additional rules for the sorts and the types. So type, the sort type itself is of type kind. So this is the goal of this kind sort I talked about previously. And then so you have a rule for making sure that a type is well formed. And so because we have dependent types, and so types can contain values and function symbols and so on, and we have the beta reduction of lambda calculus and the rewriting, rewriting rules of the user, we have this conversion rule saying that if I have a term T of type A, and A is equivalent by using these rules to some other term B, then T is also of type B. Okay. So this is something very specific to dependent types. And the consequence of this, and a property of this system is that in fact, so the type of a term is unique up to the transitive closure. So to equivalence of beta and rewriting. Well, so I have presented the lambda pi calculus modulo rewriting. So now I'm going to discuss some important properties we are interested in. So the first one is, so I summarize here all the properties I'm going to talk about in the next minutes. And I use some abbreviation for them. So for TC, I mean, so the decidability of the typing relation. So this is a very important property because it's to make sure that indeed we can check that a term is of a given type. And as you know, using the Curie Award isomorphism, it's a way to check that a given proof is indeed correct. And to prove this property of decidability of type checking, we are going to use, as we are going to see, the property of termination. The fact that rewriting and beta reduction preserve typing, and finally, so confluence. So local confluence and confluence, I will make the distinction when local confluence is sufficient. So one question we will ask is what are the dependencies between those proofs? Those properties. So we are going to see a number of results and how all these properties are interdependent. So first, what about the decidability of type checking? So the usual way to prove decidability of type checking is by using some algorithm. and mixing type inference and type checking. So I, as I said just before, in the Lambda Pi calculus, types are unique up to equivalence. So we can, this way, we can, to implement type checking, it's enough to implement some type inference algorithm represented by this up arrow here, and then to check convertibility. So when you want to check that a term T is of type B, then you first infer the type of T, and then you get, say, A, and then you check that A is equivalent to B. Okay, and so now we need to implement this type inference algorithm. So how to do this? Then this is not very complicated. So for each term constructor, you will get some rule to infer its type. So as we have seen, for instance, the sort type is of type kind, so there is no choice here, and so on. So perhaps I'm going to focus on a particular rule. So the application. So you have an application of a term T to a term U, and you want to infer its type. So the first thing is to infer the type of T and say you get C. And then to be able to apply a term to something, to some argument, then we have seen the typing rules. We need to check that we have T is a dependent product. And so here, we need to check this property. So the second thing to do is to reduce in some way this C to make sure that indeed at some point we it reduces to a dependent product. And once we have done this, we need to check that the argument U can indeed be applied to T by checking that U is of type the domain of this product. Okay. And once this is done, indeed we can conclude that T applied to U is of type, well, the codomain B, where we replace X by U. So to summarize, we get that using this technique, we can prove decidability of type checking by using the following properties. So first, termination. Here you see that we need to reduce C to some product. And for this, to be sure that this is decidable, so we need to have termination. We also need to make sure that the type is preserved along these reductions. So then we use subject reduction. And finally, so to check here the conversion between A and B, we need to have confluence. But because we have already a termination, then it's enough to ask for local confluence. So this was for the decidability of type checking. So now I'm going to speak about termination. And I'm going to focus on a result I presented last year. So it's a joint work with Guillaume Genestier and Olivier Hermand that we presented at FSCD last year. And it's to prove a termination of a combination of beta reduction and rewriting. So this termination technique proceeds in two steps. The first one is to define a function from types to subsets of terminating terms. So it's an interpretation of types. But we need a number of properties. So the property that is important here is to make sure that this interpretation of types is indeed invariant by reduction. because as we have seen, so types are unique up to equivalence, and so we need this interpretation to be invariant by reduction. So this is the first step to have this interpretation function. And the second step is to prove that when you have a term T of type A, then T belongs to the interpretation of A. And you can see that if you have these two properties, because the interpretation of A is a subset of terminating terms, then you get termination for all typeable terms. So how to do these two steps? So the first step so is to define this function. How do we do this? So I oversimplify, I do not give all the details, but with what is important is that in order to ensure this property of invariance by reduction, we proceed as follows. You know? So the interpretation of type A, then we look if it's in normal form, so it means it cannot be reduced anymore. Then we give some definition with some properties. I will not discuss here. And in the case where we have a type that is not in normal form, because we have a term that is terminating, and because we assume local confluence, then we know that it has a unique normal form. And then so we define the interpretation of A as the interpretation of its normal form. And so like this, we get invariance by reduction for free. But to do this, we need some a number of assumptions. So we need subject reduction. So it means preservation of typing by reduction and local confluence. So it may look a little bit surprising because to need a confluence property to prove termination. When you consider first order rewriting, so this usually does not happen. But because in this context of dependent types, you see that for proving termination, in fact, we need some assumptions on confluence. And so this result we presented last year at FSCD, so it was an improvement over previous works where it was required to have no critical pair on types. Here, this is not the case. What is interesting, we just rely on the existence of a normal form and the shape of rules does not matter. Okay, so this and the properties we need for proving termination. Oh, sorry, and I forgot the step two also. So in the step two, we want to prove that so if T is of type A, then T belongs to the interpretation of A. And so the solution we use for this is to have a number of conditions. So, and for rewriting, the condition we have is the following. We ask the right-hand sides of rules to be typeable. So typeable, it does not need to be typeable in the same system we want to prove a termination. So it can be a subsystem. Otherwise, we would have a circularity for proving all these properties. So for this step two, you see, so not only we need subject reduction and local confluence, but we need also the decidability of type checking, but in a subsystem. Okay, so now I come to the subject reduction property. So I talk about it several times already So let me give you some more details about this property now. So subject reduction is so the preservation of typing by reduction. So formally it means that for any typing environment on term T and U on type A, if you have in this environment gamma, so T of type A, and you reduce T to U, then U must be of type A also in the same environment. So there are many applications of this important property. So for instance, in programming languages, this will ensure memory safety, that if you have a program here that computes, let's say, a string, and you evaluate this program, indeed, you will get a string at the end and not some float. And also in logical system, as we have seen, for instance, in the type inference algorithm, it's useful. And it's also, it represents the correctness of cut elimination. It means that if T is a proof of some proposition A, and you simplify this proof T to some other proof U, then still U is a proof of A. So it's a very important property. So in our system, we have two kinds of reduction. So the beta reduction of the lambda calculus and rewriting. And so how to prove subject reduction property for each one, we are going to see. So first for beta reduction. So for beta reduction, so imagine you have a beta redex here, lambda x, T applied to U of some type C, and you want to check that if you replace, so in T x by U, you get also a term of type C. So how to do, how to prove this? So let's start from this beta redex here. And what can we say? We know that this term is well typed. By looking at the typing rules, what can we conclude? We can conclude that perhaps there is a number of applications of a conversion rule. But at some point, because we have an application here, we need to have a typing rule for application. So this is, so we get this derivation tree. Okay, so you have typing of an application and then some conversion rule before getting this C here. But so an application, so it means that the left part of the application, so is a dependent product. The argument is of type the domain of this dependent product, and then we get as result the codomain where we replaced x by u. But again, so we can do the same thing for the lambda abstraction. So perhaps before getting to this point, we applied several times the conversion rule, but at some point we need to have an application of the typing rule for abstraction. So this is what is represented here. So the abstraction here, some conversion step here, and at the end, an abstraction. So now we want to prove that when we replace T in T X by U, we get the same type. So I put in red all the important assumptions that we can deduce from the typing of the left-hand side of the beta redex. Okay, so how to use all these assumptions to get the type of a beta redux. So you can see here that if X is of type A, then T is of type B. Okay, and U is of type A prime. Okay, so how is it possible to replace in T X by U? We need to have A and A prime equivalent. Okay, and once we have done this, then in B we replace X by U. But we need to make sure that B and B prime also are equivalent in order to get C at the end. Okay. So these are the problems. So we need to prove these properties in order to conclude. Okay. And for this, you can see that we have this property that the two products, AB and A prime B prime, are equivalent. And then it's easy if we use the confluence to deduce that indeed A is equivalent to A prime and B is equivalent to B prime, and then we can conclude. Okay. So this is the usual proof of a subject reduction for beta. It is based on the use of confluence. So now I come to how to prove the same property, but for rewriting. So assume we have a rewrite rule with a left-hand side L and a right-hand side R. And we want to prove so this property that if you have an instance of the left-hand side of type C, then the same instance of the right-hand side is also of type C. So in fact, for proving this property, you will get much more details on my talk at FACD on July 3rd, where I introduce a new technique to prove this property. But I'm going to summarize here what are the important ingredients of this new technique. So to this end, I will take an example. So we consider a dependent type V for vectors of some given dimension. So you have a constructor nil for the vector of size zero. And the cons for adding an element in front of a vector of size n, and you get a vector of size n plus one. And then we want to define the tail function that removes the first element. So the tail function takes as argument a vector of size n plus one and returns a vector of size n. Okay. And so we have just one rule, this rule here. And we would like to check that this rule indeed preserves typing. So it's a very simple example, but this will show what happens and what is necessary to prove such a property. So we can look at the types. So because tail is declared with this type here, it means that so the first argument here in the left-hand side is a natural number, is of type n, and the second argument must be of type a vector of size n plus one. Okay, so it's just the definition, the type of the tail function, and the result of the left-hand side is of type a vector of size n. So to make sure that the rule preserves typing, we need to check that the right-hand side, V, is also of type a vector of size n. So we have no information on V, okay? So we need to get more details about the possible types of the arguments, of the second arguments of tail. So again, we can do the same thing. So look at the type declarations. So then the first argument of cons X must be of type A, P must be of type N, and V must be of type vector of size P. Okay, and the result of all this is a vector of size successor of P. Okay, but so then it means that in fact vector of size successor of P is equivalent, must be equivalent to vector of size successor n. Okay. And then we have a following question. So V, now we know that the type is a vector of size P, and we need to check that a vector of size P is equivalent to a vector of size n. Okay, so now how to do this, and how to do this automatically. So in this new method, there are a number of steps. So the first one is very simple, is just to attribute some new constant for the type of each variable. And I represent with a hat the type of a variable. So in the case of the tail example, so we get that so n is of type n hat, and n hat is just a constant of type, and so on. And then what we do is we compute equations on all these variables in order to have the left-hand side of some type x, which is the new constant, representing the type of the left-hand side. So this is a little bit what we have done just before. The type of n must be equal to n, looking at the type declaration of each function symbol, we get all these equations. So n is equal to n, the type of n is equal to n, the type of x is equal to a, and so on. And especially, we have that Vsp must be equal to Vsn. So I summarize here all the equations that we get for the left-hand side to be typeable. And then the next step is to simplify a little bit the equations. Because here, for instance, we have that Vsp is equal to Vsn, but V and S are undefined symbols. So by using confluence, we can replace this equation by just P is equal to N. And this is what we do in this third step. So we get simplified equations. And then now, what we do is we are going to use Knuth-Bendix completion to transform this set of equations into a convergent rewrite system. So in this case, it's very simple. You know, it's almost by using some appropriate ordering on all these symbols, orienting the equations from left to right. And the final step is to check that the right-hand side is also of type X. In which system? In the system extended with all these new rules. Okay, so in our example, it amounts to check that the right-hand side of the tail function, so V, is of type X. And V is of type hat V, which reduces to Vn, and X also reduces to Vn. Okay, so indeed, we have proved that the right-hand side has the right type. Okay, so so why do we use Knuth-Bendix completion? Here, in fact, at the step 3, we could directly go to step 5 in some sense and check typing modulo these equations. Okay. But by using instead of equations rewriting rules, we can use deducti itself to check type preservation. Okay, because in deducti, we do not have equations, but we have rewrite rules. So the step of Knuth-Bendix completion is a way to transform these equations into a rewrite system and in order to reuse deduct itself to check preservation of typing. So to conclude, what are the properties we use for proving subject reduction? You see that we need the decidability of tail shaking here for checking the right-hand side, but in at the same time an extension of the system, but also a subsystem, okay? Because we had some new rules. And also we use confluence. Okay, so we have seen many properties, decidability of type checking, termination, subject reduction. So, and we have seen for each of these properties technique how to prove this property. And each time we use the other properties. And so we can summarize all these dependencies into a graph. Okay. So you see that there are many dependencies. So for probing termination, for instance, we use subject reduction, local confluence, and so on. And I put in dashed arrows a dependency not on the same system but on a subsystem. Okay. So for instance, for termination, we have seen that we need decidability of type checking, but not of the same system, okay? Otherwise, we would have a loop, okay? And same thing for subject reduction here. But still, there are many dependencies, and we may wonder if, in the end, it's possible to prove anything at all. So perhaps we can come back to some of these properties and see if we really need all these properties. So let's come back to termination. So we have seen that for proving termination, we used a number of properties. So first of all, local confluence. So it seems difficult to get rid of this property. Already, I mean, the use of local confluence is an improvement over the previous work where it was based on full confluence. So the second property was disability of type checking. But as we have already remarked, when we want to prove the termination of a rewrite system plus some new rule, we require only the decidability of type checking for the system without this new rule. Okay, so it's a subsystem. And another property is subject reduction. So here I will do a conjecture, and this is ongoing work. I think we can get rid of this assumption of subject reduction for proving termination. So not completely, but it can be replaced by a much simpler condition, purely syntactic and very easy to check. And so that, in fact, what we need, what is important is to make sure that a rewrite rule indeed maps an object to an object and a type to a type, that there is no confusion between objects and types. And I think it should be sufficient to prove termination. So then I arrive to the conclusion. So we can simplify a little bit this dependency graph by removing the dependency between strong normalization and the subject reduction. And then, so you can see that there are essentially two possible approaches to prove all these properties. So the first one is as follows. You know. Assume that we have a calculus with a number of rules, R, and that we already proved local confluence, termination, and subject reduction, both for beta reduction and rewriting. Okay. So you can imagine that at the beginning, you start with an empty set of rules, and then so you get all these properties easily. Okay. But what happens when we add the new rules? Okay. And if we add new rules, how to prove the same properties for the system with these new rules? So local confluence, termination, and subject reduction. So I propose the following strategy. The first step is to try to prove local confluence of the new system, of the new rules. So of course, I mean, this property is not decidable in general, because we don't have a termination yet. But in practice, it's much easier to check local confluence by checking the joinability of critical pairs. And we can limit reduction to some given depth. So I think in practice, it's quite reasonable to do this. Okay. So let's assume we proved local confluence. Then using the technique I presented before for termination, we can try to prove termination. So using local confluence and decidability of type checking in the system, in the previous system. And so we get, assuming we get termination, then using Neumann's lemma, we can conclude that we also have confluence. So this is the step three. And then once we have confluence, we have seen that we can deduce subject reduction for beta reduction. And finally, we can try to prove subject reduction for rewriting using a Knud-Bendix completion. But by in a system, so extending this one, which is terminating by some specific rules. So here we need to deal with this. We need termination and confluence criteria for beta reduction plus rewriting plus some closed rules. In fact, so when we look at subject reduction, so we assume that all the rules are constant. So we have closed rules. But the difficulty is that perhaps you may have shared symbols between all these systems. So this is the first approach. And another one would be to try to prove confluence directly without assuming a termination. So there are possible methods to do this. So for instance, weakly orthogonal system, in this case, so we get confluence very easily. Also, we could use development clause critical pairs. And more generally, use techniques based on locally decreasing diagrams. So the conclusion is that we need, as you can see, for proving all these properties, we need new criteria for confluence and also tools to check these criteria automatically. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So I guess we won't upload because it doesn't work very well with this Zoom thing, but I guess we upload at least in our heads. And now I would like to know if there are any questions from the audience. So yeah, please just open your microphone and your webcam and you can all ask questions. So is there any questions? So maybe I'll start and see if there are other questions coming just to not wait. So all these criteria are quite subtle, it seems. And so my question is how much of this have been or could be formalized in order to make sure that you didn't miss some kind of small condition somewhere or And can this be formalized in deducti or at least partially?
Well, you can always try to formalize such proofs. Huh? So in deducti, currently, so deducti is not as advanced as a system like Coq, for instance, with where you have many techniques to prove theorems. But we are working on this, so perhaps in some time, you know, we will be able to do this kind of formalization in deducti.
Okay. But you didn't start anything yet, or even in Coq, or because, for instance, I know all these kind of things can be partially done. So, for instance, reducibility candidates can be implemented in Coq for simple cases. So, my question was
yes. So, yes, exactly. There are a number of formalizations. So, for instance, so some aspects of the termination techniques I've presented. But for a much simpler system, has been formalized in Coq. But it was just for simply type lambda calculus. It was not for with dependent types.
Yeah.
So as you can see, with dependent types, you get much more subtleties, so it's more complicated.
Okay. Thank you. So are there other questions?
I have one.
Yeah.
You hear me? Yeah.
Yeah, I guess
is your use of Knuth-Mendix equivalent to a congruence closure?
Yes, so I guess so. It's equivalent because it's about deciding some closed equational theory. So it's equivalent. Indeed, we could use the congruence closure. So one thing that could be interesting is you have seen that I split before doing a Knuth-Mendix completion, I simplify the equations using injectivity, in fact, of some symbols. And so it will be interesting, in fact, to combine the two steps and having so congruence closure or a Knuth-Mendix completion procedure modulo injectivity of some symbols. So I don't know works about reasoning modulo injectivity, it will be interesting. So if you have pointers to this, they are welcome.
So about this injectivity, I think that in AGDA, for instance, they don't allow injectivity of type constructors because it's incompatible with the excluded middle. So isn't it a problem, or can you be classical?
So when you make assumptions on some like injectivity and one, so perhaps it's not compatible with some other features. So then you have to be careful. So but here, for instance, so you introduce new symbols and new rewrite rules already. I mean, the problem exists, you know. So how to make sure that the system that you are defining is coherent. Okay, so it's a general topic. Also in AGDA or in Coq, you could introduce axioms that are that make the system inconsistent. Okay.
Yeah.
But you well, this is related to my question. You don't need to do that step in deducti, right? You can just use a congruence closure plus injectivity.
Yes, it could be done by some external tool. But what was, I mean, interesting and fun is that we can use deducti itself, I mean, to do this this verification. So. So like this, we don't need to to write some other tool to make this verification.
Okay, so I guess we should thank you again. So it's time for next speakers, and yeah, thank you very much.